the government were concerned about safety on the river for the Millennium celebrations, and I suppose they were particularly concerned about central London, a major inquiry which was run by Lord Justice Clark called the Thames Safety Inquiry. And as part of that inquiry, they actually went back into the issues concerning the Marchioness disaster, which had occurred several years before. And whilst there were a number of assets in terms of police boats, the fire brigade also operated a boat, Port of London Authority had their harbour launches, all these assets had their own specific tasks, and none were dedicated to search and rescue, so there was no equivalency of the ambulance service, if you like, on the there is ashore. And he said people on, say, a Class 5 passenger vessel, we call Class 5s the tourist-type vessels, should have the same reassurance of rescue in the event of an incident as somebody on a number 8 bus.
Same breeze on Pemberley.
Gravesend. Okay. Yacht broken down under the QE2 bridge. Roger that, on our way now for you.
Gravesend, we really cover an area from Canvey Island up as far as just below the Thames Barrier, sort of the Barking area. Nowhere in the lifeboat service do we have specific grounds or patches. We have approximate boundaries, but we have flank stations where we will overlap. And the Thames in particular is very important on that, because getting to an incident depends very much on the way the tide is flowing, the speed of the tide, and what the other lifeboat stations are doing. The call-outs that what we were expecting to find has pretty much turned out to be the case. Interestingly, there weren't a lot of statistics about. We knew that a lot of people did drown, particularly in central London. A lot of them were suicide attempts, or people end up in the water through misuse of alcohol, drugs and so on, and just doing silly things. Or even indeed jumping in for the fun of it and then realising it's a very dangerous place to jump into. But there weren't a lot of statistics readily available. Further down here we suspected that wouldn't be so much the case, and that would be more of an issue with leisure users getting into difficulty in what is a strong tidal river. And that certainly has panned out as very much the case. So Gravesend, over the 10 years, has turned out that we've averaged around about 100 shouts a year, so it's averaging about 2 a week, but with more of a peak in the summer, as is the case for the RNLI generally around the coast. So what we do is probably not dissimilar to the sort of shouts that coastal lifeboat stations further down the Thames estuary deal with, which is leisure users running out of fuel, breaking down, running aground, sinking, we've had yachts sink. But we also get a fair percentage of people in the water in this part of the world. So about 30% of our shouts, I would say, is probably people not from boats. Getting in from the shore, getting onto the mud, getting trapped, cut off by the tide. Youngsters go and fishing, getting their place is just over there, where it's actually quite easy to, if you don't realise the tide is coming up. Yes, we have, one of the things that we had to come up with a philosophy of how we would operate. When the RNLI agreed to put the station on the Thames, we had to agree that we would be here 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, which meant absolutely we had to have some paid crew who we could guarantee being here all the time. But the RNLI didn't want to lose its voluntary ethos in terms of setting up the Thames, and one of the things we were asked to look into was to see how we could involve volunteers in that method of operation, of having people here all the time. And the process we came up with was just having a pool of volunteers who would give up 12 hours at a time, probably about twice a month, to come in and do a shift with us as crew, with the full-time crew members. It was an idea that actually took off tremendously well, and it's given, we've been able to recruit volunteers from further afield than if they just had to rush down to the lifeboat station from work or from home. So we've been able to take crew from a somewhat wider area and give them the opportunity of working.
Okay, at Gravesend we've got an Atlantic 85. It's an 85 because it's 8.5 metres long, roughly 2.9 metres wide, has twin 115 horsepower Yamaha four-stroke outboards. These are due to give us good torque, good fuel economy and very low emissions in this environmental climate. The equipment we have on board, we have full trauma first aid kit if required, a basket stretcher for removal of casualties, a longboard if there's any spinal problems with a casualty. So we carry literally full trauma kit to deal with virtually any emergency situation.
Hey, why are you a lifeguard?
I became a volunteer here first at Gravesend because I've been a diving instructor for about 14 years. So it's kind of a way I could pay something back without actually living on the coast, because obviously before I started here, it was only coastal stations had lifeboats. As soon as I found out London had them, I was one of the first few to sort of put my name forward, and I actually joined here about May of the first year of operation. Good advice would be good engine checks, good equipment checks. I wouldn't say much of a passage plan, but just let people know when you're going out and roughly what time you're coming back. Then people know when you're missing, basically. But just general good maintenance and good care of your kit on the boat would be a good start, really.